switch it.
Well, that's a pretty much useless box. Welcome to Flindog Woodwork. Today, we're building a box with a purpose, and that's a drill press cabinet. This is something that I've been wanting to build for a long time for my standing drill press. And this is a prequel to some builds we'll be doing in the future. So let's not waste any time and dig into this build. So as I said in the intro, this is a preview to some future builds we'll be doing on this channel. As I've got this entire wall where I'd like to build some cabinets and potentially even a miter station. But before I tackle that larger project, I want to dust off my skills and tackle an easier project, and that's a drill press cabinet. And the main reason I want to do this is because I've got tons of drill press accessories with no home at all. I even have a few of my accessories stored directly at the foot of my drill press. And unlike a benchtop drill press, a standing drill press has not only the table, but the support bar and the foot to contend with. So I need to build around these obstructions, and I'd even like to put this on wheels so that I can pull it out from underneath the drill press and put it to the side if I need to. So let's start to take some measurements and get into this build. So the first thing that I want to do is to measure how tall the foot is off the floor, which is approximately 3.5 inches tall. Once I have that measurement, I'll also measure from the floor to the bottom of the tabletop, which in my case is about 31 inches. After that, we'll measure the width of the foot, which comes in right around 19 inches. And lastly, I want this cabinet to protrude a little bit in front of the table, so that comes in right at about 19 inches. I also want this cabinet to be on wheels, so I purchased these wheels from Amazon and they come in at right about 5 inches tall. I also need to know how wide the frame of these wheels are, and that's right at 2.5 inches. For the top of this cabinet, I'm going to use this piece of scrap butcher block, so I need to know how thick it is, and it comes in at right about 1.5 inches. And here's my version of SketchUp. At the very top, you can see I've listed the dimensions of the base of the drill press. At the very bottom, I've laid out a rough design of what I want this cabinet to look like. And from this design, I was able to figure out the dimensions of plywood I'll need to create the cabinet. So for the sides of the cabinet, I'll need 2 pieces at 19 inches by 24.5. For the bottom of the cabinet, I'll need 1 piece at 22.5 by 19 inches. And finally, I'll need 4 support brackets at 22.5 by 3.5 inches. So I'll head over to the table saw, make sure everything's completely square, and rip this piece of plywood to about 25 inches. With one edge of the plywood cleaned up, I'll then set my fence to the final dimension of 24.5. Then I can flip the plywood over and clean up the other edge. With both sides of the plywood cleaned up, I now want to make sure the ends are completely square. To do this, I'm going to use a rail square and use my track saw to clean up that end. And here you can see how perfectly those sides and the end come together. Next, I'll grab a T-square and scribe a line at 19 inches, which is the height of both of the sides of my cabinet. With that line scribed, I can line up my track saw and make the cut. Then I can scribe another line at 19 inches and repeat the process for the other side of the cabinet. With those 2 pieces cut to size, we can check it off of our list. Since the rest of our pieces are only 22.5 inches wide, I'm going to take our 24.5 inch wide piece and run it through the table saw and trim it down. Once it's cut down to size, just like before, I'm going to scribe a line at 19 inches and cut it down with a track saw. Once that cut's made, we can check the bottom piece off of our list. The next 4 pieces we need are right at 3.5 inches, so I'll set my fence to 3.5. Then I'll quickly rip our last 4 pieces down to size. With all of our pieces cut to size, we can strike our last item off the list. Now we need to start thinking about joinery, and for the bottom and the sides, I'm not going to do anything fancy. I'm simply going to use pocket hole screws to hold these pieces together. Now since I always get confused, I'm just going to mark which side I'm going to put the pocket holes on, and that's what I'm doing here. After that, it's just a matter of drilling out the pocket holes on the bottom side of the cabinet on both sides. Not only will I be using pocket holes, but I'll also add a little bit of wood glue for a little extra support. Next, I'll add one of these pocket hole clamps to hold the pieces together while I drive in the screws. With one side complete, I'll repeat the process on the other side. Next, I'll grab those 3.5 inch strips that we cut, and 2 of these will be added to the top and the back of the cabinet.
And these will also be attached using pocket holes on both sides. For the back of the cabinet, I'm going to offset these strips by 3/4 of an inch, and that's because we're going to be putting a 3/4 inch piece of plywood on the back of the cabinet. And these strips are very similar to nailer strips, but in the case of this cabinet, they're just holding everything square. And I'm not going to be using wood glue for these strips. I'm simply going to use the pocket holes to hold everything together. Once the back's done, I'll repeat the process on the top of the cabinet so that I have something to screw the top into. Now, if we look at the intersection of the top and the back strips, you'll notice they're butted up against each other with that 3/4 inch offset. Now, if I were hanging this cabinet on the wall, I would make that back strip completely flush with the back of the cabinet, leaving a 3/4 inch gap in between the two strips. This would allow me to slide my 3/4 inch plywood in between the two strips to give me a very clean back of the cabinet. But instead, I wanted that clean side to be on the outside, so that's why we did that offset. And here I'm just dry fitting the piece into place. And this piece is a scrap left over from our earlier cuts, so that's why it's the exact same width. But it's not the correct height, so I'll scribe a line to the correct height. So I'll go over to the table saw and align my marking with the blade. And then I can rip it down to size, and you can see how perfectly it fits.
Oh hey, sorry to interrupt this build, but I ask you to do me a huge favor and hit that subscribe button. It really does help out this woodworking channel. Also, if you're interested in any of the apparel I'm wearing or any of the tools that are used in this build, check out my website, www.flyndogwoodwork.com. That's www.flyndogwoodwork.com. Now back to the build.
With the frame of the cabinet put together, I'm now just confirming the measurements of 19 inches deep by 24 inches wide. And the reason I'm taking this measurement is because I want a 2.5 inch overhang for the cabinet top. So I need to add 5 inches to both of those measurements and cut the butcher block to 24 inches by 29 inches. So I'll first cut the block to 29 inches. Once that's done, I can make the 24 inch cut. Then I can place that butcher block on top of the cabinet just to make sure everything looks okay. So now that we have the basic structure of the cabinet built, we need to start thinking about the drawers. And in this case, I went with 16 inch drawer slides just to be safe. So we need to figure out the drawer dimensions, and obviously we know they need to be about 16 inches deep. But to figure out the width, I like to place the drawer sides into place and measure the distance in between the drawer slides. I also want to take a measurement on the interior height of the cabinet to figure out how tall the drawers can be. And after all those measurements, this is the math for the dimensions of the drawers, assuming I'm using 1/2 inch plywood. So in this case, I'll need 6 pieces at 20 3/8 of an inch by 7 inches, and 6 pieces at 16 inches by 7 inches. So let's get started on the first 6 pieces, which are 20 3/8 of an inch by 7 inches. So I'm first going to rip my plywood to 21 1/4 inches just to clean up that factory edge. And I've got 2 pieces of 2 foot by 4 foot 1/2 inch plywood, so I'll need to do this twice. With a clean fresh edge, I'll then rip it to its final width at 20 3/8 of an inch. With the plywood cut to 20 3/8, I now want to cut the height of the drawers, which is 7 inches. And that completes the 6 pieces that we need for the front and the back of the drawers. Next, we need to work on the sides of the drawers, which are 16 by 7 inches. So I'll first adjust the fence to 16 inches and cut them down to length, and then I can cut the height at 7 inches. Once all the pieces are cut, you can see how these drawers will come together. And to attach these drawers, I'm simply going to use pocket holes on the front and the back of the drawers, which will never be seen. But before we join the sides of the drawers together, I want to figure out how big the bottoms of these drawers need to be. So in order to figure out the size of these bottoms, I need to do a little bit of math, assuming a 1/4 inch dado that the bottoms of these drawers will slide into. After all that math, I come to the dimensions of 20 7/8 by 15.5. So I'll adjust the fence to 20 7/8 and make my first cuts. After that, we can trim the bottoms to size at 15.5. With the bottoms cut to size, we can place them to the side. Next, I want to cut those dados into the side of the drawers that the bottoms will fit into. To do this, I need to set my saw blade height to exactly 1/4 of an inch. Once the blade is set, I'll then move my fence over to 1/4 of an inch. Then I'll run each of the sides of my drawers through the table saw. Now in retrospect, I probably should have set this to 1/2 of an inch, giving me a little bit more space on the bottom. Once I've made this first cut of the dado on all 12 pieces, I'll then tap my fence over just a tad and make a second cut. And I'll just cut one piece for this process. After that, I'll take a scrap piece of the 1/4 inch plywood and test the fit. And in this case, that fit is exactly what I was looking for, so I'll go ahead and make the cut on the remaining 11 pieces. With the dados in place, I can then do a dry fit on the drawers to make sure everything comes together nicely. Satisfied with the results, I'm now going to do some pocket holes to join these drawers together. And as I said before, I'm only going to add pocket holes to the front and the back of the drawers, which are the two longer pieces. The pocket holes in the back will obviously not be seen, and the pocket holes in the front will be covered by drawer fronts. Once I have those pocket holes drilled out, I'll screw them together, adding a little bit of wood glue. Once I have three of the drawer sides joined together, I can now slide in the bottom into the drawer. After that, I can add the final piece and glue and screw it together. Then it's just a matter of repeating that process for the other two drawers. And if I had any recommendations on doing this process, I would use regular clamps versus the red corner clamps, as those corner clamps are quite tedious to add and they tend to move on you. And just like that, we have three drawer boxes built. Next comes the fun part, adding drawer slides. And in this case, I chose the side-mounted drawer slides that are soft close. So the first thing that I've done here is drawn a line at 1/8 of an inch as an offset from the front of the cabinet. And this is what I want to line up the front of my drawer slide to. Once I have those alignments made, I can pre-drill the holes for that drawer slide. Now the reason I'm doing that 1/8 inch offset is because the drawer slide has a spring in it. By having that offset, this will ensure that the drawer face is pulled snugly against the base of the cabinet. And that's because the spring in the drawer slide will cinch that drawer face in, creating no gap between the cabinet and the drawer face. Once I have my rails attached to the cabinet, I can then move on to attaching the rails to the drawer. In the case for the bottom two drawers, I'm aligning the slides flush to the bottom of the drawer. Once all the slides are installed, I can install the bottom drawer. Next, I'm going to use a scrap piece of 3/4 inch plywood as a spacer for the second drawer, still making sure that I'm aligning my slide with that 1/8 inch offset. Once everything's aligned, I can attach my hardware to the cabinet. Once again, for the second drawer, I'm aligning the bottom of the slide flush to the bottom of the drawer. After that, we can slide our second drawer into place. Now, I'm not sure what was off of my measurements, but for my final drawer, I had to use a piece of 1/4 inch plywood for my spacer, otherwise my drawer wouldn't fit. To get this drawer to fit, not only did I use a 1/4 inch plywood for the spacer, but I also raised the slide by 1/4 inch from the bottom of the drawer. And although a little bit tight, it still allowed the drawer to fit. I think part of the errors in my calculations had to do with me wanting to make the bottom drawer just a little deeper. That way, I could fit just a few larger items into that drawer. But either way, it all worked out, and now it's time to remove those drawers. With the drawers removed, we can now flip the cabinet over so that we can work on attaching the wheels. And here I am just penciling in where those screws will need to land on the bottom of the cabinet. Once those markings are made, I'll pre-drill a hole at each one of those spots. And then it's just a matter of mounting those wheels to the bottom with screws and washers. And I'll leave a link in the description for these wheels. These are some of the highest quality, larger wheels that I've seen at this price point. Once those wheels were attached, I wanted to roll this thing underneath my drill press to make sure all my calculations were correct. Happy with the results and with all my drawer slides in, I now want to attach the back. And to do this, I'm simply going to add a little bit of wood glue into the seam. Then it's just a matter of sliding that panel into place. With the panel in place, I'll flip the cabinet around and drive in a few cabinet screws to hold that panel in place. Now let's get back to that butcher block cabinet top. What I'd like to do here is put a small roundover both on the top and the bottom of that butcher block. And to do this, I'm going to use a 1/4 inch roundover bit to soften those edges. And this gives me a chance to use my favorite router. If you haven't tried out this DeWalt Palm router, it is a game changer. Once I've got one side done, I'll flip the piece over and do the other side. And as I said earlier, if you're in the market for a palm router, I really recommend this one. And if you do get one, I would recommend the corded version, as it just has just a little bit more power than some of the battery-operated routers. With the edges softened, I can now place this butcher block on top of the cabinet. And since we cut this top to have a 2.5 inch overhang on each side, I can simply use my double square to center the cabinet top. Once I'm happy with the alignment, I'll pre-drill and countersink holes where I can attach the top of the cabinet to the base. And to attach the top, I'm not using anything fancy, just 1.5 inch wood screws. After that, I'll place the drawers back into place so that we can begin to work on the drawer fronts. And after cutting out the top, I have just a little bit more of this butcher block left, so I'm measuring here to make sure that I have enough material to carry this butcher block onto the front of the drawers. And it turns out I'm just a little bit short, so I'm going to have to do a little bit of resawing. But first, I'm going to cut the remaining butcher block in half at just a little over 7 inches. Once I've cut them in half, I'll take my Milescraft center finding jig to mark out the center of each board. With my lines marked out, I can now line up the blade of my bandsaw to that center line. Then it's just a matter of resawing the two pieces of butcher block right down the middle. And this is where this Bow dual level feather guard came in real handy, as it gave me all the horizontal support I needed to make sure that my board didn't drift. Once the boards have been cut, you can obviously see there's a lot of bandsaw marks, so we need to get rid of those. And for that, we'll head over to the planer. And I really didn't have an exact thickness I was shooting for, I just wanted the boards to be clean on both sides. Next, I'll go back to the cabinet to confirm the width of the drawers, and in this case, it's once again 24 inches. So over at the miter saw, I'll set my stop block to 24 inches exactly. So I'll square up one side of the drawer face and then I'll cut it down to size. Once I have my drawer faces cut to size, I'll apply some double-sided tape to the drawer fronts. Then I'll slide a piece of scrap 1/4 inch plywood underneath the drawer. This plywood's going to give me support as I stick my drawer face to the front of the drawer. Once the face is stuck to the drawer, I'll reinforce it with a couple of clamps. With the face temporarily attached to the front of the drawer, I'll mark the center point on the face so that we can attach our hardware. And this is a jig that makes it really easy to drill out the holes for your hardware. I'll leave a link in the description below so you can go check it out. Once your holes are drilled, it's just a matter of screwing on the handles. Once the handle's in place, I'll throw in a couple of cabinet screws just to secure the face to the drawer. Once the first drawer's done, it's time to move on to the second one. For the second drawer, I chose to use a little bit stronger double-sided tape as I was getting a little bit of movement from the drawer face on the first drawer. And here you can see me placing an 1/8 inch setup block on top of the first drawer face so that I can get the spacing of the second drawer face. Once everything's aligned, I'll once again mark out the center of that drawer. Then I'll break out my jig once again and drill out the holes for that hardware. Then it's just a matter of once again screwing in the handle and throwing in a couple of cabinet screws to secure the face to the drawer. And I'll repeat this same process for the final drawer.
Well, that just about covers the entire assembly of this drill press cabinet. The only thing left to do is to sand this down and put some finish on it.
Now, a little bonus of having this cabinet on wheels is it makes it a heck of a lot easier to sand. Once you're done with one side, you can simply turn the cabinet around and get the other side.
And just like I do with most of my shop furniture, I'm going to put on a little bit of Danish oil and call it a day.
Now, I don't know if it was just this piece of butcher block, but this butcher block was really thirsty. I've put on about 5 coats of Danish oil, and this thing is still absorbing that oil. Once that cabinet's all lubed up, it's time to put it in its home. And I'm really pleased with the results of this cabinet. I really like the way that butcher block carries from the top of the cabinet all the way down to the drawer fronts. Not only was this project a lot of fun, but it's given me a little bit more confidence to tackle the harder project of installing cabinets throughout my shop. I've just got to remember to continue to add a few more coats of Danish oil until this cabinet's thirst is quenched.
Well, thanks so much for joining me today on building this drill press cabinet for my stand-up drill press. If you haven't already, make sure you hit that subscribe button, leave a like, and leave a comment. Until next time, take care as always.